Hello, Horace here with another episode of the Abdani campaign. And if I clear my throat and cough a whole lot more than normal, hard to believe, I know, then it's most likely because I have a cold. It was brought to our dwelling by our smallest member when they visited family afar. So, anyway. Here we are at Carthage, which is now an Irish island in the middle of a sea of Africans, apparently, who are Latin Christian. Interestingly, we have a situation where we're just gonna keep doing what we're doing, so to speak. We do have the remnants of Africa down here at Tingis, but they seem to be busy raiding Tingis and doing nothing else of any value, so we're going to let them keep doing that. See? There. That's what I was telling you. We do have this problem, though. That is the Wild Warriors, the Lombard attempt to come back to Britannia and force their hand. And we really don't have much of a garrison in Londinium, so if they land, which they probably will, and they are able to reach the city, we're going to end up in problems.
Ready for orders.
Now, I got an option that I can do that I didn't think of prior. I could attempt to lay an ambush somewhere around here within the sphere of influence. I know for a fact they're not going to be able to land down here and take Carinium with the amount of movement points they have. They will, I think, the closest point of disembarkation that actually is a value, because I don't count this, because that's impassable terrain, would be right over here. So, well, yeah, because that's impassable too. I don't even understand these. I mean, I guess they're just because they're ambient, which is fine. They look nice, but they're completely pointless. So it would have been kind of neat to see a mechanic where it was like, if you're such and such faction, or your army is made up of this type of unit, or these types of units, they can pass through impassable terrain, like skirmishers, or, you know, raiders, some non-normal type of troop that has some special ability that are really good in the wildlands. So I am actually going to move him out. I know I'm going to take some winter attrition, I think, because we don't have Champions of the North yet here, which, that's fair. Even so, I think we're going to be okay. That'll put us close enough to be able to aid and give us 50% ambush possibility here, so that's what we're going to do. Ola Marie will just kind of hide in the terrain. Like I said, he's within distance to reinforce Londinium. I'm assuming I'll be able to do that, because I think even in ambush, unlike Rome 2, you can come to the aid of the city, which definitely was not the case in Rome, like I said. Caledonians are sieging Saguntum and raiding in Britannia Inferior. That's fine. Saguntum's probably gonna fall. I will take it back. I will declare war on these guys, but honestly, it gets me rid of these guys, which, although very nice to have, I think we're coming to the end of our good nature with them, just because we want their territory. We're trying to make a Celtic Britannia. In order to do that, we need to eliminate the Romano-British, which is what these guys are. So, besides, they got plenty of land down here, and we have been watching this civil war, as I mentioned from last time. Constantinople is under Dacian control, the Principate of Dacia. So, for all intents and purposes, they are now the Eastern Roman Empire, or to be more specific, the Roman Empire, because the West is gone too, really. I think they might have reemerged, maybe? Doesn't look like it. So, yeah, I think they're completely gone still. So, that's fine. Thessalonica is under Macedonian control and pagan. Looks like Greek Christianity may be on the downward spiral. We definitely got a hodgepodge of different religious tolerances over here in Asia Minor, so we're gonna see how that turns out. But we also have to watch this. Sassanid Persia has apparently gobbled up most of the East between it and its client states. Among them is the Lakhmids, who control a large area. Judea does not control Aelia Capitolina, which is what's left of Jerusalem, but the Garamanti do, which is strange. And the Himyar have apparently struck up from here and have an empire in Arabia, so we also need to be worrisome of that. But anyway, in our neck of the woods, we got some order, sort of, which is good. We were going to make this into a trading center, so we're going to keep going that way. It is very rich, 1720 already. We're going to spike that quite high, so here we go. Just kidding. Apparently we need to give the these guys certain capacities. Do I have anything? Well, I got agriculture, but that really doesn't help me here. Military developments? No. We'll do... negative 5% for military buildings doesn't really help me either. You know what? We're just going to go for the wealth from agriculture. Eventually, we'll flesh out this province, and we're going to need that. Messenios, our great king, in charge of his trade empire. He has had nothing really he's been able to do. We do want him to go for Olam, which gives us a lot of sanitation and a lot of tax rate. So, spike that up to the top. That's 10% extra tax rate in the province he's governing, which is unfortunately just Eblana at the moment, but that will probably change eventually. Most likely not before he dies. He's 52. But gives us a lot of sanitation too, which is going to come in handy if we want to upgrade stuff and we don't yet have this unlocked. So, alright. Now we can end the turn. So I have been playing some Last Roman Vanilla, and it's been...
As clouds gather, wise men look for friends to shelter them. In you, I believe we have such friends.
Okay, I think that in this case, we should be capable of having a good alliance with them. They're not at war with Gaul. And it looks like they got good trade relations with everybody we got. Chances are Lombards may land here, and then I can just intercept them and take that last province. I'd be happy with that, so we're going to try for it. Oh, no, they're just going to land. That's fine with me. I'll just hunt them down and destroy them all. So we are going to get a battle, it looks like. Hopefully, we are still at the height of our tech, but like I was saying, a vanilla Last Roman campaign as the Ostrogoths. I haven't had so much trouble with the political tool as I've had in that campaign, in a good way. Historically speaking, there is a civil war that's going on between Theodiscus, or something like that, the presumptive king and grandson, I think, or grandnephew of Theodoric the Amal, who is the famous Theodoric the Ostrogothic king of Italy, who overthrew Odovacar, the guy who overthrew the Western Empire's remnant. So, two parts removed. Yeah, that's right, we did the Latin Christian oppression, so public order up to negative 10 bonus from the presence of Latin Christianity. Good. Good. Well, we have a full army there, and we're not going to make money. And we've secured a lot of loyalty, so that's all good. Oh, that's interesting. Himyar and the Sassanid Empire are button heads. Apparently their empires are bordering each other a little too closely, and the friction's getting a little chafy. So anyway, yeah, they're gonna keep doing that. You can try to muster something, but I just don't think it's gonna happen.
Ready for battle.
But anyway, the down in Italy, Flavius Odovacar was a I believe he was a part Skiri general. He was the Magister Militum for the last family who ruled the empire. Of course, the famous last emperor of the West was Romulus Augustulus. But I think, from what I remember, that's a lot of food. We're gonna do it though, just because, well, frankly, we need to rise this city up high as we can get it, as high as a pizza pie. So, and they're just gonna camp down here south of Tingis and probably raid next turn. Even though they're not getting any snow attrition, they're acting like they get snow attrition down here. That's not snow attrition, guys. That's people leaving because they've given up the cause. So anyway, I keep getting distracted. Yeah, so we're gonna start this battle while it's loading in, and we're deploying and stuff. I'll continue. Yeah. Should be able to reach them. Oh yeah, they're not running either. They do have an onager, most likely too. Germanic warband, Germanic spearmen. Celtic warriors, I can deploy, of course, inside their range, and I have all these towns, which are great. They do have those pikes, so I don't want to hit them up front. I've only got a select few spearmen, but they are good spearmen, Frankish mercenaries. Germanic hunters are pretty good bowmen. And I really don't have anything except for the hounds to go against them. I do have some Roman auxilia, which is good. I still think I'm gonna be okay, so we're gonna fight it. And maybe get a peace with them. So, Flavius Odovacar was the Magister Militum, or Master of the Military, equivalent of Commander-in-Chief for the Western Roman Empire under Romulus Augustulus and his, I believe, stepfather or something like that, who was a senator. I forget what his name was. He's not important anyway. All he was a power behind the throne, which failed. And honestly, the power behind the power behind the throne was always Odovacar. He knew this, and he finally had enough of dealing with the squabbles and political intrigue of the West, which was, by this point, pretty much just Odovacar. And he got the Skiri, which was a Germanic tribe and the employ of the Western Empire, operating as mercenaries and federati, which were, I guess you could say, second-class citizens of the Empire. Ooh, pretty. We're going to do it, because we don't really get a lot of chances for weather, and this looks fun. So, in a snowstorm. Very neat. Hopefully it runs well. It kind of acts like it might lag. And we can see their mercenary onager, so that's good. Oh yeah. That's happening. Aw. Really? Never mind. Not happening. These guys are gonna go here, though. So anyway, Odovacar was an interesting person in the sense that he might have been a descendant of a barbarian tribe who had second-class status, but he was able to gain the position of Patricius, which by this point, Patricius anyway is pretty much just what we would call patrician. It's a rank of aristocracy within the Roman Republic that eventually got used in the Empire as a kind of badge for what your status was, and if you had it, you're really good. But of course, and this is going to make them scramble, so I kind of like that, so I'm okay with this. We're going to do that, because honestly, they're heavy melee infantry. Really? They kind of don't look it. Well, I guess some of them do. They got chainmail. But, anyway. The because we can. The position he had was annoying from the perspective of he had reached pretty much the top of the tier and he couldn't get any higher, and he had ambitions. And he was tired of seeing these supposedly higher class, upper class Romans, i.e. the patrician who was ruling the empire under his stepson or some such, abusing the country that he served, which I think he did serve loyally. He felt like he did. And he got tired of watching them destroy it from the inside and decided it was time to simply eliminate the issue. He assassinated the father figure and, well, honestly, the last emperor of the West was so ignominious, he was simply placed under house arrest for the rest of his life, which was great. Interesting person in the sense that he was always going to be a little bit of an outsider from the rest of the patricians who did make up the Senate, which by this point, although not really a legislative body, more or less just a gentleman's club, was still very influential. And it did actually matter still, to him at least, and probably to the rest of the world, what the Senate thought of him. So he did a lot to make sure he didn't look like another usurper, which honestly, the West was getting the reputation of simply every year changing emperors, usually by violent means. So he was able. I'm still gonna have to go up this hill, and I don't like that, but at least this is keeping those guys occupied. So, yeah. The situation for the. Wrap up that flank, I think. That's probably going to be the best bet. So, in that case, you guys wrap around. You guys follow them. You guys. Yeah, grow auxiliary, so prove yourself.
We have sighted the enemy!
So yeah, I mean, when it's all said and done, that's pretty much the way the West fell. But of course, they still, even Odovacar didn't consider the West fallen. Yeah, there was no Western Emperor, but his theory behind it, or at least the one he sold to the Emperor in Constantinople, was we have no need of a Western variant of his, of the Emperor of the East. So instead, we're going to reunify the empire under
the enemy is attacking our general.
The Eastern Emperor, and in his place, we're going to place a governor in charge of all of Italia. Of course, he kind of made sure to not keep the peace that stated that he was. That he was going to put mint his own coins, and on those coins, ready. Call himself Rex, in other words, king. But he was Nonetheless, Odovacar considered himself a continuation of governing of the Italian peninsula, which, of course, was all a sham. Most historians agree on that, but as to just what that meant to him, I don't think he necessarily believed that the two were exclusive, that you could be, put yourself as king of Italy and still be considered part of the reunified Empire of Rome. And obviously, the title of Patricius still held a huge sway to him. He loved putting Patricius on things just as much as he liked the Brax. But Odovacar was one thing, he was a Siri. He didn't decide to become a emperor, also because I think his subjects in Italy would have not liked that, most of which had higher claims to it than he did, simply for being Roman, not a outsider, as they assumed he was. Hopefully you can hear me. I have a feeling this battle is very loud. So I'll probably leave it there for a little bit while we stop. We are taking a lot of damage. Why are we taking so much damage? That's what I want to know. Okay, guys. That way.
Enemy units have been rallied! We hunger for blood and battle!
There's no cavalry in here, so I really didn't have to keep my spearmen in reserve. So I'm fine with that. And these losses will eventually recoup themselves, so not a problem there. I'm gonna wrap these guys around the skirmishers.
Their general has fallen! Our victory grows ever nearer!
I thought they said our general had fallen. I'm like, I highly doubt that unless he's like the only guy who fell, which has happened in other campaigns, i.e. my first one in Rome. Okay, we are wrapping that flank. There's quite a lot of people running for it, so I'm going there. How we destroy a Lombard army. Yep, Galaglass is the pretty good. Never gonna catch them, but we'll send them. We have stained the snow red. I'll keep the Germans at bay for a little bit anyway. Should make them think twice. That's my theory on that anyway. Even the dogs are still getting killed, that's awesome. Pretty sure they're all gonna die anyway. But anyway, so Odovacar, his kingdom didn't survive him, obviously. Theodoric the Amal, on behalf of Eastern Empire came to restore order after Odovacar had a falling out. I believe he didn't fight in or die of anything other than assassination, but correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure that's accurate.
Ready for orders.
Oh, they didn't just all die, of course, because there is a crossing point, and they're close enough, I suppose.
Warriors, all.
Well, we'll eliminate them. Balance dance. That way we use the onager to effect. And take on the extra warriors. Come be part of the Celtic world.
Defending
our position.
You'll
see a world of pure Celticism, I guess. Now we can get that, and we're now immune to winter attrition, which is awesome. That was worth it. So, I think I remember what I was doing with this. I was actually going to take this down for now and get a sanitation building, but eh. We seem to be okay, and it's not like one of my armies is in there, so it'll probably be alright. Good reason to do anything, right? It'll probably be okay. So anyway, yeah, I just wanted to see if that was the king of the Alamans, and it is, and he is not the guy they start with, Macrium, I think. So, yeah, they've had a coup, or guys died of old age, which is a possibility. It's 4 or 5. But anyway, public order's still good. But Odovacar's kingdom, like I said, was taken over by Theodoric the Amal, leader of the Amal-led Goths, as it's called in the records of the time period, obviously. The Amal were apparently either a family or a unique or elite tribe within a greater Gothic nomadic group that had settled somewhere in Pannonia, which was right there on the upper Danube. So, apparently the Amal-led Goths would later be known as the Ostrogoths, or the Eastern Goths, Goths of the Rising Sun, whatever you want to call them. They were interesting. Okay, the Maurians are at war with the Alamans. The Alamans have no real territory near me, just their king sitting out there. I should probably ally with them, considering what's going on, but at the same time, I'm also curious to see if we're going to have a German situation down here. So you know what? Besides, the Alamans have good relations with the Suevi and the Franks, as well as Italia and the Marcomans, so I'm gonna actually decline this alliance. Break it. Probably gonna really upset them, and they'll probably declare war on me, but I feel like it might still be good. And their king's out at sea, so it's just like Lords of the Ocean or something. I don't know what's going on, but anyway. The Amal-led Goths came in to Italy, set up their position after an internal coup. Oh, and Africa has redistinguished themselves at Tingis, and they actually got too many troops there for me to take, so that was smart. But we'll get to them later. Maybe we can get a peace treaty. No use walking dusty tracks in my good robes. Traveler's robes, okay. Well, you're a little elitist. Abdani and the Marians, of course, we're no longer peaceful. Marians and Alamans are at war. The Varinians have been found. Apparently, Dacia is at war with the Vandals. We'll see how that goes. Africa, good conditions in spring. Not that they really matter, because we don't have much. But anyway, we do have a trade depot here. What does that give me? That gives me food. Might be worth it. So we're gonna do it.
thirsty for battle.
Do we have that? Yeah, we got our serpent stone, so awesome. The spread of Celtic religion should now be starting to happen over here. And for whatever reason, we still got like the shrine building that's associated with Nordic tribes. I think that it really would have been neat to see a little more diversity in building structures, but whatever. But anyway, let's see what's going on over here in the east. Quadi have come in. Doesn't look like anything going on over here. Looks like a stalemate in Asia Minor. That's fine. I know that the Danes have control of all this, but it looks like the Geats are possibly going to take Haven, which is their original starting point. Not the Geats, but the whatever they're called, the Danes, those guys. It's been a long day. It's like the end of the day, and I went into work for an early shift, and my brain shot. Plus, I'm just took some painkillers because I threw my knee out while mowing. This has not been a good day. but what can you do? Anyway. Yeah. How much food we got? We got a lot of food, actually, so... Small city. We'll deal with it. Let's get you guys bigger and better. Faster. Stronger. All that. Nothing else going on here, so we'll keep going. So, anyway, the Amal-led Goths took over Italy on behalf of the Eastern Emperor, so for all intents and purposes, the whole official position of a surrogate in charge of the Italian peninsula on behalf of the Eastern Emperor continued. Only instead of Odovacar, as Rex, it was now Theodoric, who, again, called himself Rex and Patricius, named so by the Emperor in the East, I believe it was Zeno. Anyway, it wasn't long before they were simply known as the Eastern Goths, or Ostrogoths, to differentiate themselves from the Gothic kingdom in Iberia and southern Gaul, which was thereafter known as the Visigoths. Or Western Goths. That was pretty much how they would stay during the following century after the fall of Rome, West, officially anyway. Visigoths being their own independent kingdom, Italy being governed by the Goths. The interesting thing did happen with the Ostrogoths, and it is kind of neat because it is kind of represented in the last Roman campaign, if you played it vanilla, at least. Yeah, we succeeded. Woo! Religious influence plus 10 Celtic paganism faction. Why? That's actually really good. So, yeah, that is woo. Yeah, that's gonna stay like that. Illyria and the Vandals are at war. So, I'm guessing the Vandals are somewhere around here. So, well, the interesting thing about the Ostrogoths, like I was saying, was that they integrated into the Latin population of Italy. That is why whenever you're playing as their faction on either Attila, vanilla game, or the last Roman campaign, you are actually able to recruit, at a certain point at least, Roman units. That's because the population didn't convert their culture to Ostrogothic or Gothic culture. In fact, they created a kind of synthesis where they, for you Mass Effect fans, there you go, where they converged the two cultures and made something new yet fun. It wasn't really Italian culture yet, but it was something in between. A lot of Germanic and Danubian elements to it. Of course, the ruling class was Gothic, because Theodoric, of course, and all of his family was there. and all of the infighting that was famous for that was there, but they did at least keep a lot of the Roman laws and legal system, and they kept the Roman aqueduct network and the Roman roads working. Tolls and taxes were collected just like they were during the Western Roman Empire. For all intents and purposes, Italy seamlessly integrated into the Dark Ages a lot better than the rest of the Western European nations. And this guy will go ahead and do that, because why not? Back. And we'll do that, because we want the extra ammunition in case we come under siege, and the food's nice. Oh, duh. And we have one more, so construction negative 6. Very good. Plus 1 cunning, which is also good, I guess. Anyway. A lot of turns going by, hence the reason why a lot of history happening, but yeah, why not? Saturation, yay! Anyway. And we'll upgrade that too, because we really need to get our population growth to a point where we can build that sanitation building and everything will be fine. Fine, yes, very fine. So, the Theodoric's realm was very stable during his reign. It was actually, and he was a very good friend of the Romans, apparently, both the Romans of Italia as well as the Romans in the Eastern Empire, and of course the Emperor in the East. But he was, as the Ostrogoths were, and as Odovacar apparently was as well, Arian Christian, which is that heresy, according to the Catholic Church, and before it, the Latin Imperial Church, that gave Christ two separate natures. Essentially, he was, he was, it pretty much, the way I've heard it explained, he was either fully God, or he was fully man, but he wasn't both. He was either fully God, masquerading as a man, or he was fully man, and he attained godhood. In either case, it was considered a heresy by the official Roman Church. And of course, to this day, the official Christianity of the world considers it a heresy. So, of course, this is important because Italy is famous for being home to the Bishop of Rome, also known as the Pope, which did exist at this time. And during a lot of the turbulence, was more responsible for the governing of the Italian peninsula than, in fact, the Goths were. But this would be in a time right after Theodoric. When Theodoric was around and before him, Odovacar, those guys did actually rule the Italian provinces just like a governor. It was after Theodoric died that things kind of degenerated and the Pope took on a lot of responsibilities for the daily governance, and that's why you get the problem of papal states and does the Pope have temporal authority versus religious authority and all those wonderful things that come into the Middle Ages. So we get another mission, which gives us the exact same thing we got before. Goody. Spread your religion to the majority of this region, at least the Pope. We might be able to do that, I say, without knowing anything. Rugians and the Danes are at war. Good. Saxons are now Celtic pagan. Very good. Like that. Ostrogoths are at war with the Vandals as well. So we've got like a free-for-all war going on here. Civil War's kind of stopped because everybody's fighting over here. The Sassanids and the Himyar are fighting over there. And the East is pretty much a mirror of what happened in the West. So, interesting. We kind of... I'll go for that. And during those turns, I might be able to build up enough to buy that sanitation upgrade as well. So, we'll do that. We'll hold on to our money for now. Partially because I want that, not these. Although, Britannic Rebels and Scotty Pirate would be neat. we'll wait on those until we get probably Britannia Inferior, or maybe even Oasis up here in Hibernia and Caledonia. But in either case, yep, that'll work. Ooh, we do have plague. Consumption, good. I hope so. I say we're gonna save our money, but we actually need this. That happened. Anyway, that's okay. We're gonna make it, and then some. So, like, our money is better than I've ever had at this point in the campaign. So apparently this is the best way to play Attila, I guess. But it's so weird. It's so weird. Anyway. So after Theodoric dies, there's a problem. His official heir is in minority, Theodogisclus, which at the last Roman campaign is just an adult and had been under the rulership of his distant family member, uncle or something like that, stepfather, I don't know which, Theodahad. But, ooh, that's not good. Where'd the Franks go? Franks better not be dead, guys. I like them, and I want them to take over Gaul eventually. Gaul's nice as is, but they just deserve Gaul. I mean, they're the Franks, for crying out loud. Eventually, they become France. Anyway, that took me off topic a little. The situation, though, with Theodahad was that Theodogisclus, while he was in minority, wasn't the official heir. So you're getting a lot of political intrigue. In the last Roman campaign, this whole meander through history kind of leads to this, the political campaign play for the last Roman Ostrogothic campaign in vanilla, at least as I've been playing it, has been remarkably accurate to what it would have been like. Right off the bat, half the people are disloyal. There's civil wars that keep peppering my campaign, and I have to put them down while being wary of Justinian's reconquests and dealing with Burgundians and Lombards. Visigoths being my friend 1 minute, then a new king comes and wanting to take over my kingdom and hating rival empires and so on and so forth. At the same time, my armies are made up of a mixture of Gothic and Roman troops, which is kind of cool. The Ringians are here. Cool. That's awesome. And Acapos, attempting to organize Latin Christian worship. Such things are forbidden here. Oh, that's a new one. Kind of makes sense. So Acapos is trying to... well, if we execute him, he becomes a martyr. We could be tolerant, but I don't think that's our thing. We leave him in prison. We can let him rot. Hopefully that doesn't cause a rebellion. So leave him in prison, though. That seems just. It's just as the Dark Ages get, anyway. So I'm gonna put you as Elder Doratios. You're unable to do anything in the Olamri. Now be a judge as well. Good job, guys. Good job. So, Petassos, companion, please. Vodenos, Elixo. Yeah, and Panios. Yeah, I'll put him as an elder. He's earned it. He's got a lot of stars. He's governor of Lusitania, so that's kind of tough. So anyway. Oh, Rionrix. Public order, please, because we're gonna need it. Elixo! Same thing. We're gonna need it. Oh yeah. Less so here, but still, you know. So, anyway. A lot of so's, but that's my thing. that campaign has been a lot of fun. I'm enjoying it, and I'm hoping it doesn't end anytime soon, really, because I'm enjoying just trying to govern and hold on to my political position. Theodahad's still alive. Theodogiscus, like I said, is an adult, but he's stationed up in Liguria. We just beat back the Lombard invasion, which is cool, but they're not dead, which is kind of also nice, because that means they might try again, or they may become fair weather friends and decide to turn their sights on Burgundy, which I'd like. But anyway, it's a lot of interesting gameplay. It's been a fun campaign on that one, and it's kind of reinvigorated my hope for Attila being able to do some things it was meant to do, such as the political play, because that has made a lot of sense. And I'll say that the Mercian campaign I did as vanilla Charlemagne, Age of Charlemagne campaign, was also made a lot of sense. It was really fun. So anyway, that's my long tirade through the episode, mixing history with interesting aspects that I liked from my campaigns. Of course, none of which are this campaign. This one still got the radius mod, the unit mod add. But anyway, oh, Britannia is calling back forces. Apparently they've gotten word that Caledonia are making a bid for their home territory in Britannia Inferior.
For the tribe!
The Geats were destroyed. Well, that was a turn, because they had a large army here. But wow, a Dane showed up and did stuff. Yeah, you can afford it. Pay him off. Yes, we want to pay him off because we don't want rumors. Everybody else gets that. Illegal practices. Left to rot in prison, his followers grow restless and agitated, so Latin Christian opposition just increased again. Yeah, that's alright. The city got bigger, too. So, we're still fine. Yeah. Ooh. Western Empire has emerged, as it often does, at Corrales. So, Sardinia may see yet another emperor in the west. This guy, Septimus Catulus, has apparently been lifted upon the shields of his soldiers and rebelled against his Garamantian overlords, taken position and possession, I should say, of Corrales, and declared the Western Roman Empire once again alive and well. We'll see if it truly is well. Looks like, actually, the Suevi have declared war on the Gaetuli, and I must have missed that, because they've taken over a pretty sizable chunk of territory with Caesarea and Constantina. I don't like them having Constantina. That's in my province with Carthage. At the same time, though, the Marians, not the Garamanti, the Marians, I'm sorry, are, I think they're actually on the way out. That might be the last of their territory right here. So, we might as well take it. But let's see what we got going on here. Corinum. We got enough food, so we'll do well. Definitely.
Ready for orders.
That might ease that issue. I need his cunning up, otherwise I continue going down here to Olam, which would make sense since he's Olam Re.
For the tribe.
Oh, I guess I can do that too, that's integrity. Also good. But we gotta get that up and going.
Orders.
Well, we just did that, apparently. Okay. So anyway, those are fun campaigns I'm really enjoying. And I really wish I could play more of them, of course, right now. That's just not possible. I've got too much going on. And apparently I'm hard on my body. But who knew? Yeah, Constantina is probably going to break away. Let's see the state of the Maori. They have two provinces.
Welcome. Honored emissary.
They are deteriorating.
Speak,
let's help them.
And
more.
I will answer with.
Next turn, we should be able to declare war on them. We could get involved in this empire issue. We got neutral Macedonia, they're just kind of holding steady. Dacia, which of course is the Eastern Empire right now, that's deteriorating, though they are reliable. They are not at war with Britannia right now. That would explain the stalemate. Caledoni have just taken that territory, which I don't like. Looks like they like me, but... cry not loud, I do not like them. We are tanking our diplomacy over here. We're going from 22 to 17. Which is great. Britannia here is deteriorating. I don't think they're going to get their armies up here in time to save what's left of that. Can't say I'm going to blame them. Oh, the Franks still exist. Good. They have Belgica, and they're on that side of the Rhine, which is even better because that's pretty historically accurate. Although, they have this, which makes no sense. Of course, I don't make sense either. I mean, look at my territory. But, you know. They make lesser sense. So there. Gaul is... deteriorating, actually, and I don't like that. So are they. But they really like me still, so...
Your people's reputation goes before you. Find a welcome here.
I'm gonna do that, because I can. And that'll help kind of keep them on good nature. They're more important to me right now. I kind of want to take that province, but I don't know what they have. Guess I could scout and see. They don't have any forces, so none that can reach Elisabo, so I'll be fine there. Looks like I'm still going to take some negative penalty. Oh, good. They left it open. So next turn, we will take Tingis. Then maybe even Tamosiga. And they're probably going to return back, because the Prince, Prince Valens here is probably not going to like that. Hopefully they don't take the Marians out. Well, actually, if they do, I'll just raffle stomp them, which is easy enough. They got three provinces, not two, sorry. Three towns, I should say. But anyway, this is where I'm going to leave it for now. I don't know how long it's been. It's probably been about an hour. I haven't been paying attention to the time. Who cares? It's been a lot of turn play. We got a battle in. Not much else going on. East is dealing with a whole lot of side things. And the Western Empire has risen again-ish. We'll see if it stays alive. So, interesting gameplay. And good discussion, I think. A little bit of history to push in. It's always fun. And relevant history, because of course it's the right time period. But anyway... this is where I'll leave it, so until then, I will see you later.